Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Glory and honor, dominion and power be to God forever and ever. Christ is risen. Alleluia.
As we come in this joyous worship this morning, we come recognizing the fact that we need the Savior who died and rose for us. And we need to be honest about that fact and receive again his forgiveness. So let us join together in our prayer of confession. Almighty God, we thank you for the liberating power of the resurrection and for the promise of new life in Jesus' name. With humble hearts, we confess that too often we give only lip service to the truth of the gospel. We speak of your love, then pick and choose those we deem worthy. We trust in your grace, then refuse to forgive as we have been forgiven. By the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. Friends, hear and believe the good news. Christ is risen. The stone is rolled away. The tomb is found empty. And Mary calls out, "I have seen the Lord."
We are God's people, called to a new way of life in order to proclaim the mighty acts of the one who called us marvelous light.
In the name of Jesus, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Julian. The book we know as the Psalms was originally written as a hymn book. It's the Psaltery, the hymn book of Israel. And this morning, as we come to the reading of our Old Testament lesson, you'll notice that we are doing it as it deserves. This is very simple. You and I, our role is to sing the refrain right there with the musical notes, "This is the day the Lord has made," and our signal is a bell chime. And so even as we sing and listen, may God's word take root in our hearts and lives.
This is the day.
Ah, well done. And a beautiful message and set up to our time of prayers. On this Easter Sunday, I think the world is especially in need of our prayers. And perhaps we ourselves, as each day the news seems to be more dismal than the one that preceded. The good news of the gospel is God knows, and God alone holds the beginning and the end of human history. And in that we can find tremendous confidence. And so would you join me as we go to our Lord in prayer? Our gracious and glorious God, what an honor, a joy, a privilege it is to be able to gather together in worship, raising our voices, our hymns of praise with brothers and sisters around the globe. Lord, we are so grateful for the gift of life and for the gift of amazing new life in your Son, Jesus. We are humbled by the darkness of our own culture and people and this world. And yet at the same time, we are grateful that when you look at the mess we've made of things, you respond with grace, with compassion, with love. And so we lift up our prayers with brothers and sisters in every nation, praying for peace, praying for the wars to end in so many nations, praying for refugees, praying for those who are languishing in despair without hope. We confess we do not know the way through. And yet, throughout human history, you have broken through miraculously, supernaturally, time and again, bringing peace where there had been no hope, bringing justice where justice had become a distant dream. And we pray, Lord, that you would do it yet again. We pray for our own nation. We pray, Lord, that you would remind us who we are, that you would grant us a spirit of humility that allows us to live into the slogans, "In God we trust." We pray that we as citizens of earth and heaven would be diligent to come alongside those who feel marginalized, those who feel oppressed, those who feel as if the world looks down on them and does not have room. Lord, give us the heart of our Savior to seek to save the lost. We pray especially on this Easter morning for so many who find the words, "He is risen," who find the songs and the jubilant hymns a sad reminder of how broken and how desperate their moment is in history. We pray for those who mourn, that you would heal the brokenhearted and comfort them. We pray for those who battle mental illness and those who love them. We pray for those who battle addictions of various kinds. And Lord, we pray that we as the church would be quick to come alongside those who are struggling for hope. We pray for ourselves that you would build us up in faith, that the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, would truly shape and transform and enliven our lifestyles, our language, our actions. May we, at the end of this day, find ourselves baptized anew in the living spirit of the one who embraced even suffering and death on the cross, so that we might live free, liberated, powerfully aware that God is with us. And so hear us as together we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
One, of course, of the things that we do is bring ourselves and bring an extension of ourselves through our gifts before the Lord. We celebrate the resurrection as we empower the church to proclaim the gospel and to serve the world in Christ's name. We are receiving today not only our ordinary offering, but the one great hour of sharing, which is the special offering that is given on Easter Sunday. Let us worship God now as we bring our tithes and our offerings before the Lord. These are our gifts to you. Receive them, O Lord our God. Use them for the furthering of your kingdom here and throughout the world. As the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, risen and conquering, comes to this world once again. Receive these gifts and bless them for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen.
Hear from the Gospel of John, the account of Easter. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. She ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been around Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in. He saw and believed. For as yet, they didn't understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
And all the Lord's people said,
Amen.
Well, one of my favorite things to look forward to on an Easter Sunday is hearing Julian read the gospel lesson. And for those who don't know Julian, and for those who may feel that, oh, I'm too far along in years to be of use to the Lord, know that he's 99 and still kicking. He is my icon. And as he read, every year when the Gospel of John is part of the scripture lesson, I'll have at least one or two people approach me a week that follows with a few questions. The first one is, who is this other disciple? The one whom Jesus loved. Well, that was a literary form by which the writer of the gospel, John, could speak of himself. He's speaking of John. And then they say, but wait a minute. He entered the tomb, saw and believed. So doesn't that mean that the men first understood the gospel? And my answer is no. We keep it in context. He saw that the tomb was empty. He saw that the linen cloths, the shroud that would have wrapped Jesus' body, was laying out on the slab. And the unique, there's a special word for it, the handkerchief, the headscarf that was wrapped around a corpse's head in Hebraic tradition, that was neatly folded and left right where the head would have laid. And so John and Peter left believing the tomb was empty. So now we pick it up. And again, this is God's word coming from the Gospel of John, chapter 20. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. This is Mary Magdalene. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, Woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him in Hebrew, Rabboni, which means teacher, rabbi. Jesus said to her, Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We made it. And for all of you who battled open bridges and traffic, if God were into brownie points, you would get an extra dozen. Well done for staying the course. I must say, it's been a really busy season this year. And I often, like you, get stuck on 75, get stuck coming along the side roads to the chapel. But a few weeks ago, I picked up a new tactic. I now look forward to those moments when I am stuck, and I'll share it with you. It's a four-letter word. S-I-R-I. Okay. Kids, I'm waiting for you to explain it. Okay. Siri, yes. Now, you can only do this. Don't try it now. But when you get home, try this on your Siri, on whatever type phone you have. It is so cool. You can be alone in the car, and suddenly your blood pressure goes down, and all is right with the world. Just find the right question. Give you some of my favorites. Siri, do you have a boyfriend? Here's the honest answer. Why? So we can get ice cream together and listen to music and travel across the galaxies only to have it end in slam doors, heartbreak, and loneliness? Siri, what is the meaning of life? Now this one, the techno geeks change periodically, but my top two favorites have been: all evidence to date suggests it's chocolate. or, I don't know, but I think there's an app for that one. And this being the season in America that it is these days, I tried this one, which I will yet try again. Siri, are you a Republican or a Democrat? Here's the honest answer. The only thing I know about politics is that there are parties. Yay, parties! I love it. And isn't it amazing? At the same time we laugh, isn't it amazing how quickly, as a culture, we have become dependent on Google and Siri to answer our questions. Some time ago, I was explaining to one of my grandsons that when I was a little girl, our TV set was about this big and it was black and white. He looked at me like I was crazy, and then finally said, "Was the whole world black and white?" 2 days ago, I said to him, "You know, when I was a little girl, we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have Google." He does not believe me. He does not believe me. And I think, my goodness, how times have changed technologically. Some of you may remember when the first wireless telephones were announced, Motorola. I was 20 years old. Back in 1973, you can do the math. Remember, it weighed 2.5 pounds. And kids in the audience, you're gonna love this. The cell phone, the top of the line cell phone of those days, would last 30 minutes before the battery ran out. And it took 10.5 hours to recharge. Technology has changed just about everything. But I'll tell you what has not changed on this Easter morning. The questions, right? The questions we ask, the questions that trouble us, are timeless. Is there a God? And if there is, does that God know I exist? And if that God knows I exist, does that God care? What is the reason for my life? Is there a purpose when I can no longer go out and earn a paycheck? Is there life after adolescence? The questions. One of the things I love most about the Gospel of John's account of the resurrection is that he includes two questions that are so essential and lie so much at the core of your and my existence and our faith. If you've never done so, when you go home today, open up the back, just the last few chapters of each of the four Gospels. And as Isa has been sharing in the adult class, he was talking about it just an hour ago, each of the four Gospels is according to that writer, their recollections, the way they've put it together. You go to Matthew's account of the resurrection Easter Sunday morning, there are no questions. He tells the story. You go to Mark, the only question that is raised is between the women as in the darkness they're stumbling toward the cemetery. And the question they ask back and forth among themselves is, but who's going to roll the stone away? And then you come to Luke, my favorite of all the questions, I'll confess. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? But for today, it's John. And to tell you how important the question he asked Mary is, it is asked of her twice. A question you and I would never in our wildest moment ask somebody standing by a tomb in a cemetery. First the angel, and then Jesus himself says, "Why are you weeping?" You know how our brains work, how we can have an entire conversation? We can write a story in a nanosecond, in a flash. John doesn't tell us the inner workings of Mary Magdalene's brain when she heard that question, but I've got to tell you, I kind of guess where her brain might have gone. Are you kidding me? Why am I weeping? What planet are you from? Don't you see I'm standing by a tomb? Can't you tell the tomb has been messed with? I'm weeping because the man I've been following for 3 years, the one I love, the one I trusted in, the one I hoped would redeem our nation, he was brutally killed and traumatized. Haven't you heard? And here you are asking me why I am weeping? He's gone, and I don't know where they have taken him. Whew, to her credit, she holds it in. And her response is very dignified to this unexpected, almost outrageous question. Having said that, I love the fact that Jesus picked it up and asked again. I love the fact that where Peter and John left her sobbing, and that's what she was doing. The words in English do us a tremendous disjustice. The original word is lkleo. It's the Greek word for uncontainable, loud sobbing. It's the same word used three other times in the gospel. Once when the babies and the toddlers in Bethlehem were slaughtered by Herod and their mothers, and the city sobbed. The second time, an unnamed woman who washed Jesus' feet with her tears sobbing. And then the third time, only a few days earlier than our scripture lesson, when Jesus looked down over the city of Jerusalem and wept. And so I love the fact that where Peter and John left her, Jesus not only sees her, but wants her to know he sees, he understands. Woman, why are you weeping? Whew. Do you know what he did for her? He did for her what he does for you and I when we are undone. He gave her permission and an opportunity to find words for her trauma and her confusion and her questions and her grief. And even as he gave her an opportunity, if only in the silence of a flash of a mind, to put words to what she was feeling, he didn't linger there. He did what he does for you and me. He took it a step further and said, "Who are you looking for?" That's the question for Easter. The sad reality is too many people say, "I'm not looking for a who, I'm looking for a what. I want a little financial security here. I want God to take away the cancer, take away the fear. I want to make sure my kids are okay. I want to pay off the mortgage. I want to be able to play more golf. I want. But the question of Easter, the question of that first Easter, the question of right now is, why are you weeping? What is it that you're afraid of? What's unsettling you? And who are you looking for? I love the fact that Jesus asked that. I imagine him doing so kind of with an impish wink. I mean, really? I mean, if you and I were flies on the wall, if we were angels watching this, it's like, oh my goodness, he's actually asking, who are you looking for? She doesn't know it's him. He's standing right there. I love the fact that he is so relatable, so human, even in his most divine appearance. And I am a firm believer that it is that same Lord, that same Spirit, that is whispering your name. And if it were possible, I would quickly say out loud each and every one of your names, because I hear Jesus asking you, why are you weeping? What are you afraid of? What keeps you up at night? Who are you looking for? It wasn't too long ago where Billy Graham, now 97, he's a child next to Julian. Wasn't too long ago where Billy Graham was at a conference giving a speech, and a heckler in the crowd called out, "God is dead, God is dead." And Billy Graham, one of my true heroes, did what he does so beautifully. He walked to the edge of the stage, leaned over, and said, "Huh, how strange. I was talking to him just this morning." And isn't that the good news of the gospel? God not only knows your name, Jesus himself, the living one, is right beside you. You may not see him, you may not feel him. Even the strongest believers go through dark nights of the soul where we feel like our prayers have bounced off the ceiling and nobody is listening, nobody is there. Don't ever let that stop you. The reality of the gospel, the reality of Easter morning is Jesus knows your name. Jesus is right beside you, and Jesus is not waiting for you to wake up and say, "I need you, Lord, I love you, Lord, I want you, Lord." He's already whispering, "Here I am. Are you ready? Can I come in? Will you slow down? I want to spend time with you today." It's the unexpected presence of a man who was dead. It's the unexpected tenderness of a God who stooped to our conditions so that when we are weak and hungry and thirsty and sad, he understands. That's good news, yes? That is worthy of the trumpets, and that is worthy of the accolade, "He is risen." Finish it for me. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we are so very grateful for the reality and the truth of the gospel message. We are so indebted to you that when we were walking in darkness, confused, weak, and afraid, that you were there. We are grateful that when we are weak, you give us your own strength. And when our faith falters, when even our belief in you is thin, you stay where you are beside us. You whisper our name, and by your grace you pull us back from the edge, filling our lives with purpose, with courage, with grace. May we always be there for you, channeling your grace to the world you love. For we ask it in our Savior's all-powerful, all-conquering name. Amen. A quick reminder, parents, you are free to start picking up your children to take them out to the Easter egg hunt, which will be right outside these doors. And next Sunday, worship is at 10. But now let us prepare to go out into the world bold and unafraid, knowing that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit are with us now and will remain always. Amen. Amen.